What's up, Substance? Make some noise wherever you are at. You made it to church. We are so blessed you're here today. If we haven't met yet, I'm Pastor Peter Haas. My wife and I started Substance a while back. And today, what I want to do is I want to talk about this topic of how to be used by God to accomplish the miraculous. Over the years, I've had a lot of people tell me, you know, Pastor Peter, I don't know if I've ever seen a true biblical miracle. I mean, like kind of the undeniable miracles we read about in the Bible. And a lot of people, though, they overcomplicate the miraculous. And at Substance, I think almost every single month we have a crazy miracle story come out of our church. And I want to talk about this a little bit. And we're going to do this by studying a simple little Bible story that I really believe is going to cast vision for how God wants to use you today. And so if you have your Bibles, why don't you turn with me to Acts chapter 8. And I'm also going to have the verses up on the screen. But just to give you a little context, we're going to read a story about a disciple named Philip. And of course, the Bible teaches this is after Jesus died on the cross. He rose from the dead. So this takes place in the early church. And he has this bizarre encounter with an angel. And we're going to start reading in Acts chapter 8, verse 26. It says this. Now, an angel of the Lord said to Philip, "Go south to the road, the desert road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza." So he started out. And on his way, he met an Ethiopian eunuch, an important official in charge of all the treasury of the Kandake, which means the queen of the Ethiopians. This man had gone to Jerusalem to worship, and on his way home, he was sitting in his chariot reading the book of Isaiah the prophet. The Spirit told Philip, "Go to that chariot and stay near it." Okay, so just to put this in context, I want to make sure that you guys don't miss this because I want you to appreciate just how totally weird this is, okay? So this angel shows up, tells Philip, "I want you to start walking into the desert, going south," and then disappears, right? And then he's thinking, that's it? That's all the info I get? Like literally an angel comes and tells, no more instructions? I mean, it's almost like begging, like why only that? Okay, like so he's either going to decide I'm going to do it or I'm not, right? And so he's like, okay, I guess I'm going to just walk into the desert heading south, right? So you could just put yourself in his shoes, right? He's literally just walking in the desert thinking, why didn't the angel give me more? And yet all of a sudden he sees this chariot and God just impresses upon his heart, "Philip, go walk up to that chariot," right? I mean, I would call it like a divine nudge, just an impression, a hunch. Walk up to that chariot and just see what's about to happen. Because again, he had a holy suspicion something's going to happen. I mean, how weird would it be if he just walked on this road and nothing happened and then he just goes home and it was like, wow, God, thank you for the exercise. You know, because maybe that's what God wanted. Maybe God was just saying, hey, you need to exercise, right? Send an angel to that person. Get on your treadmill. You know what I'm saying? Like, I don't know. Like it's got to be something, right? So he has a holy suspicion. And so he walks up to this chariot. Now, I want you to stop and appreciate just how weird and mystical the Bible is. I think it's okay to acknowledge that it's unique. I mean, if God said to, I mean, imagine if an angel came to you and said, hey, I want you to walk down Nicollet Avenue in downtown Minneapolis. And then you're just walking thinking, okay, that's kind of weird. And then the Lord just says, go out, hang out next to that car. Right? I mean, it's weird. Okay, so Philip does this. This is exactly what he does. And as he's standing by this chariot, he hears this Ethiopian dude who looks kind of well-to-do. And obviously, if he had the book of Isaiah, he had to have been wealthy because that would have been an expensive thing to own in those days. And this Ethiopian dude is reading a prophecy from Isaiah. Now, if you've ever read Isaiah, there's some chapters that are harder than others. But let's just say it can get confusing. And he happened to be reading the very passage in Isaiah that was referring to Jesus, the Messiah, right? And so Philip is listening to him do this, and he could hear that he's confused, and he's thinking, what are the odds? And why? Because he's thinking, I am a world expert. I am one of a handful of people on the face of planet Earth that could possibly interpret that exact passage of Isaiah with accuracy. That has to be the divine appointment. That has to be the reason why the angel sent me here. That has to be be the divine setup that God wanted me to clarify for this Ethiopian leader, right? And so fast forward the story, just to give you the rest of the story. It ends up being this divine appointment where Philip explains, this is who Jesus is. This is who Isaiah was prophesying about. And the guy was so blown away by the whole experience. He's like, you know what? I need to be baptized. And so he gets up out of the chariot. They find water and he baptizes them. And then the weirdest thing of all happens, right? He's baptizing this Ethiopian. And the Bible says the moment he came out of the water, all of a sudden Philip got zapped and just to a different location 34 miles away in Azotus. And of course the Ethiopian guy, he comes up out of the water and then Philip just disappears randomly and he's like, what in the world just happened, right? I mean, if you were God, okay, just think about it from God's perspective. If you were God and you wanted to make an impression on someone, why not just beam them out like Star Trek? You know what I'm saying? I'm just like, sometime in my life, I'm just hoping that God will do that for me one time. I mean, it'll be a little weird when I show up 34 miles away. Now what do? Which way do I walk, angel? Okay. Now, but think about it, okay? Why would God do that? God wanted to make it unmistakably clear to that Ethiopian. This was a divine appointment and you need to remember this. And guess what? History tells us that Ethiopian official did remember it. In fact, actually, if you study church history, we know that Ethiopian official ended up going back to his country and he ended up jump-starting a revival of Christianity in that area that exists to this day. There is a huge number of churches that guy ended up planting that have impacted Ethiopian and Somali culture for generations. And I believe that one of the reasons why we are told this story is because God wanted to communicate to us that a tiny little act of obedience can actually lead to a huge national revival. Just one silly little moment, a little nudge, go up to that car, go up to that chariot. Something as simple as that can actually be a catalyst for a revival that exists even 2,000 years later. And so the reason I'm even sharing this with you, church, is because I really believe that over the years, I've learned to pay attention to that still small voice of the Holy Spirit impressing upon my heart, those little nudges from the Holy Spirit. You know what I'm talking about? Those little impressions. Peter, call up your old friend and have a conversation. You know what I'm saying? Something as simple as that. I have a divine suspicion. God, what are you up to? Why did you have that person? You know, like when God just suddenly randomly brings somebody to your mind, you know, and maybe you're like, well, how do you know that's not just a random thought in your head? I don't. Okay, but what I do is because I live with holy suspicion, because I live with a sense of anticipation that God is going to do something unique, I'm always asking God, why did that person get brought into my head? Okay, and I'm not asking everybody to get all spooky and mystical, and at the end of the day, we still, all of our impressions, we have to judge it according to scripture, and so if God tells you to rob a bank, okay, chances are that's not actually the Lord, okay, just wanted to clarify that for some of you, but I just, you know what I mean? Like, I do believe that if we live with holy suspicion, that God can use us to do the miraculous. And it's not, God isn't asking us to do miracles. He's asking us to obey the still small voice, and he shows up with the miraculous. Do you see how that works? You see, God just needs you to have that little bit of obedience, that little step that all of a sudden creates a chain reaction. And that's how Christianity works. It's really quite simple. It's really quite simple. It's kind of an example of this. I'll never forget, right after we planted Substance, I got to hear the story of this one pastor named Stefan from Germany. And of course, this pastor, Stefan, he happened to have a rare opportunity to lead an 84-year-old woman to Christ, which is kind of rare. Most people that receive Christ do it before they reach 18. And so to lead an 84-year-old woman to Christ, I thought, you know, that's pretty cool. And which goes to show, hey, it's never too late to turn your life over to the Lord. It's never too late to say, here I am, God, use me. And of course, this woman ended up becoming a Christian. And it was just in time, too, because within 3 years, she got diagnosed with a terminal illness. And she ended up getting hospitalized. And of course, Stefan would go and visit her in the hospital and just read the Bible to her, things like that. And even in the hospital, despite her diagnosis, she was one of the most joyful Christians ever. And of course, even her doctor knew, wow, she is a She has a contagious joy that is absolutely unique. And so Stefan would come in, and he'd come and he'd visit with this woman who's now 87 years old. And of course, the doctor would come in and hear them fellowshipping and talking about Jesus. And the doctor would even kind of tease them, like, "Hey, wow, you guys really are into this Jesus thing." You know what I'm saying? Like, and they're like, "Yes, we are." And she would testify, "Hey, 3 years ago, I gave my life to Christ. It's been the greatest 3 years of my life." And it was almost hard for the doctor to believe that she could be that joyful, especially with that terminal illness. And yet, there she was. And Stefan would come and pray with her on a regular basis. Well, fast forward the story. A few days later, that 87-year-old woman ended up going home to be with the Lord in heaven. And a few days after that, randomly, Stefan, the pastor, he gets a call from the doctor who'd walk in during their visitations. And the doctor was like, "Hey, Stefan, I don't know if you remember me. I'm the doctor who took care of the woman that you would always visit. And honestly, I would come in and I would hear you guys talk about Jesus. And I'm calling you because, well, in all of my years of medicine, I've never seen anyone face death with such peace. I've never seen anyone face death with such joy. And honestly, you and that lady have something that I don't have, and I just want you to tell me about it. Please tell me more about this Jesus thing you have." And of course, Stephanie shares a little bit of Christ with him on the phone, and he says, "Well, hey, you know, why don't you just come? I'm actually facilitating a church service tonight at my church. Do you want to come?" And he's like, "Yes, I would love to." And of course, you know, Stefan on the phone, he's thinking, "Wow, this guy's really into it." And sure enough, the doctor showed up at church that night, and Stefan was like, "Wow, you made it." You know how you invite people and you're still kind of shocked? You know what I'm saying? Like, he was almost like, "Wow, you actually followed through it." And he's like, "Hey, why don't we, after the service, why don't we process? Let's go hang out after the service." And the doctor was like, "Yeah, let's do it." Well, okay, at the service that night, Stefan was praying for healing. It was kind of a healing service. And he's like, "Hey, if any of you have illness in your body, why don't you come forward? We're going to pray for people," kind of like we do here at Substance. After every service, we always offer prayer. And so Stefan, he was offering prayer for anybody that had diseases or illness. And sure enough, this doctor actually had an illness. And he's like, "You know what? Even though he was kind of new to this whole God thing, he thought, why not just try it? Have Stefan pray for me." So the doctor came forward. And once again, Stefan was like, "Oh my gosh, you're like really interested in Jesus." Like, okay. So he prays for the doctor. Well, get this. That night, the doctor was instantaneously, miraculously healed. And it so freaked him out, that miracle. Him getting healed, it so freaked this doctor out that when the doctor and Stefan were driving after the service to process it, the doctor was like, "I've never in my entire life experienced a miracle like that. That was just over the top. Stefan, please, 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 please. I need this Jesus. Please, I need to accept Christ into my life. Can I do it now?" And he pulled right over on the side of the road, right, this busy highway on the hard shoulder. And Stefan is like, "Whoa, whoa, whoa, you're not stopping here, are you?" And he's like, "Yes, I need to receive Christ now." "Okay, yeah, we can pray right now for you to receive Christ." And so, you know, he thought, this is kind of a bizarre place, maybe even a little dangerous to be pulling over on the side of the road late at night, but okay, yeah, we'll pray. And so he starts praying with the doctor to receive Christ. Well, get this. While they're praying, all of a sudden the police officer drives up behind them and like puts his lights on and comes up and it's like, "What are you guys doing on the side of the road this late at night?" And the doctor was like, "Well, I just discovered Jesus and so we're praying." And of course the officer was like, "Sure you are, you know, because everybody loves Jesus when they're drunk, right?" So I mean, like, I'm just, and sure, so he goes, "Why don't you get out of the car?" And he gives them a sobriety test. He wanted to make sure that they were not on things. And so they ended up passing the sobriety test, and he realized, "Oh, you're not actually drunk. Wow. You guys actually love Jesus." You know, and the doctor is like, "We do. And young man, someday I hope that you can experience what I'm experiencing because it is over the top amazing." Well, okay. So fast forward another couple days later, take a wild guess who calls up Stefan the pastor, but the police officer. And the police officer was like, Stefan, I know I'm the police officer that kind of came up to you guys the other night when you guys were praying on the side of the road. Clearly you guys have something, you and the doctor have something that I do not have. Would you please tell me about this faith you have in Christ? And so of course, Stefan invited him to church, and guess what? Not only did the officer come, but he brought his girlfriend along with, right? And the story just keeps going on, gets crazier and crazier and crazier. And here's why I'm even telling this to you, church. Is because, for starters, I believe that our God loves to create chain reactions like this. And in some ways, if you think about it, all of us are a part of a divine chain reaction that he's doing on the face of this earth. All of us are a part of a spiritual lineage that someday we're going to be able to look back on it and map a little spiritual family tree of all of our lives. Someone at some point either invited you to church or invited your relative to church or invited your relative's relative. You know what I'm saying? We're all a part of this chain reaction, and I believe God loves to do these types of things. But the second reason I'm sharing these stories is because I fundamentally believe that people are way more open to God than we care to think. People are way more open to the gospel than we may just judge with our rational minds. I think a lot of times when we look at people, we're kind of assessing them. Do they look like a type of person that would be open to God? And you know, like, oh, that person doesn't really seem like the type of person who would be interested in church. But let me tell you something. You don't know that. In fact, I think about myself on the night when I gave my life to Christ, okay? When you're a DJ in a nightclub, usually people aren't thinking, oh, that guy loves church. You know what I'm saying? Nobody would think that. And yet, if somebody would have judged me based on my outward appearance, I would have actually looked quite intimidating to that individual. But thank God somebody followed that divine nudge and led me to Christ that one night, because it changed my life. I'm so glad somebody didn't judge this book by its cover, because the truth is, I was crying out for something real. I was crying out for something that actually made sense. I knew, even as a non-believer, that this entire crazy world didn't just spontaneously appear out of nothing and then boom, here we all are. I knew that's not rational. Even I knew that's not scientific. Even I knew every cause has an effect, every effect has a cause, and there's no way this universe just exists spontaneously without some sort of creator out there. I'm just saying, and there's a lot more people that are experiencing a deeper work from the Holy Spirit than we care to admit. But if we judge a book by its cover, if we just think that, oh, God's working in that person's life versus that person's life, we're going to miss some of those divine opportunities. And that's what one of the first lessons I really believe when it comes to the miraculous. If you really want to see more miracles, then stop looking through your rational eyes. Start looking through your spiritual eyes. Get a holy suspicion. Because if you have a holy suspicion, I really believe, because think about it. I mean, even Philip, he had to have enough time in his schedule to be willing to just walk along a desert road and do something a little random. And I think for a lot of us, miracles increase in proportion to the margin of our lives. Miracles increase to the proportion of the margin in our lives. If we're too busy to be used by God, guess what? You're not going to experience the miraculous. Because sometimes it does take a little wild goose chase. The same thing is true with financial margin. I believe that God wants to do financial miracles. I think same is true with our emotional margin. God will move in proportion to the margin that we have in our lives. But if we're not willing to go on a few little wild goose chases, I would rather be wrong trying to obey God than be wrong not trying to do anything. I would rather pray for 100 people and see one person healed than pray for nobody and see nobody get healed. Are you seeing how this works, church? Okay, there's a certain degree of divine math that goes into this. But at the same time, you and I have to be willing to be going about our lives with a holy suspicion and say, hey, maybe that person got brought to my mind, not because it's just a thought in my head, but because there's a divine nudge that the Holy Spirit wants to use me to do something unique. And I just, in some ways, it kind of reminds me of what happened back in Death Valley, back in 2004. Now, if you've ever been out west, Death Valley is like a little desert west of Las Vegas, okay? It's actually one of the hottest places in the continental United States. And part of the reason why it got the name Death Valley is because it hardly ever rains there, and it's extremely hot, right? So Death Valley, right? So, back in the winter of 2004, they had a super rare storm system drop about 7 inches of rain in a very short window of time. And of course, you know, the rain, all this water just disappeared right into the cracks of the ground. But what was interesting is all of a sudden, a few weeks later, come springtime, the valley erupted into this giant field of flowers that no one in the region had ever seen before. It caught everyone off guard, including the people that worked in this Death Valley Park. And that event became known as the 2004 Super Bloom. In fact, you can look this up online. This event, they gave it a name, the 2004 Super Bloom. And it turned out that Death Valley wasn't so dead after all. In fact, there were lots of seeds in the ground. They just didn't even know it. There was all this potential sitting in the ground. They just didn't know it because those seeds were dormant. But let me tell you something, church. Those seeds were there all along. All they needed was a little bit of rain. And I believe the same is true with people. I believe the same is true right here in the Twin Cities. I believe that there are seeds sown into the dry hearts all over this city, all over this state. There are people who are way more open to God than they look. Okay? They appear dry. They appear cracked. They appear crass. They appear judgmental. They appear hyper-political. They appear ornery, and yet deep in the soil of their hearts, there's all sorts of God seeds that are just waiting to germinate, waiting for the fresh water, the living water of the Holy Spirit just to fall on them, and they're open to God. They just feel incompatible with church. Or maybe they just don't get it. They're like Philip reading Isaiah's, you know, and thinking, what in the world is Isaiah saying? I mean, come on, let's be honest. There's a lot of things in the Bible that are really difficult to understand. Let's just be honest. That's why at the end of the day, I believe a lot of people are kind of like that Ethiopian in Acts 8. They're open to spiritual things. They just need someone to kind of put it all together and help it make sense. They just need a church to simplify it, and they need a Philip to interpret it. And unfortunately, a lot of people, they just don't have that. They don't have the church that'll simplify it, nor the Philip to interpret it. And so for most people, they just kind of check out and say, forget it. I maybe just this whole church thing, maybe it's just not for me. And church, the reason I'm sharing all this is because one of the reasons why we as a church are constantly trying to go over the top, especially if you've ever been to one of our Christmas services before, you know that we love to go over the top for these, because we just want to show people, hey, church can actually make sense with your everyday life. That God, this God of the universe, actually wants to be involved in your life on a daily basis. And so one of the reasons why we go over the top is just because we want to show people church can be different than the church you gave up on. And in fact, research has shown that some of the top reasons why people don't go to church, check these out. Let me give you four reasons why a lot of people don't go to church statistically. Number one, people quit on church right now in unprecedented levels because there's too many rituals they don't understand. There's too many traditions that just don't sync with modern life. You know, for example, nobody's sitting around cruising in their car listening to organ music, right? So why do we do this at church? It's a sign of detachment. And maybe you're out there and you're that one person who's like, you know, at that stop sign. I'm just saying most people, they listen to something else. In other words, what they do in their personal lives is fundamentally different than what they do at church. And so a lot of people, they just check out because they don't know how to cross that chasm. Number three, they quit on church because it's boring. Or number four, they don't trust the kids ministry. They actually don't feel safe. And obviously with all the scandals going on in the Catholic Church, you could understand why a lot of people just don't want to even risk it anymore and going to some church with a low quality kids ministry. And number five, the other reason is they just don't believe that the pastor, like when they're talking about money, they believe that the pastor is out there doing crazy things with it. So, which that's why here at Substance, we're always trying to be open about how we spend our money. We're trying to be, have really clear, safe, secure kids ministry. That's why we're always just trying to do things that make the gospel even feel more relevant, is because really a lot of the reasons why we do what we do are trying to counteract some of these reasons why people leave churches. It's just to think about what is it in our culture that needs to be counteracted, and what can we do to help people comprehend this gospel in a way that makes sense. And by the way, on a quick side note, many of you guys know we film our a big Christmas sitcom every year, because I remember growing up at church, and sometimes it felt like a really boring variety show, if I could say it that way, on Christmas, and then we light candles and it was just like, no thanks. So like what we try to do is just to keep it a little more exciting for people of all ages is we film a little sitcom, and oh my goodness, wait until you guys see this. It is so fun. You guys are going to love this year. Oh, and in fact, I was even like, hey, to our media team, can we quick give everybody at Substance a quick sneak peek so they can know what to look forward to? And so is that okay? Do you guys want to see a little sneak peek of our sitcom? Just a tiny little clip? Okay, just to set up the clip, the plot line actually follows a teenage girl who keeps reliving the same miserable day over and over and over again. Kind of like if you've ever seen the movie Groundhog's Day way back in the day, except she's reliving the last day of 1999. Check this out. I'm just telling you, you do not want to miss Christmas this year. It's really fun, even just to see our team get better at filming stuff. We actually filmed the sitcom using the same equipment they used to film The Lord of the Rings. And I just, with all the talent in our church that we've got, I guarantee you there are motion pictures in our church's future. We're going to be having a lot of fun in the next couple of years. But I want to encourage you, make sure that you take those little invite cards for Christmas this year, because it really will be an incredible moment. And with all that said, what I want to do is I want to end today by just giving you one last story of the type of impact that God wants to use you to accomplish. Many of you might be familiar with a delightful couple here at Substance named Mike and Missy Evans, and they're just some really fun people within our church, and they lead a foster care ministry here at Substance called Foster One. And what they do here is they've helped dozens of families become licensed by the state of Minnesota to become foster care families. And even more, what they do is they help other families come around these foster families just to be supportive and really help them become successful as parents. And I think that's just so beautiful, because that's the gospel in a nutshell. We're the family of God, and we just want to welcome more people into family and love on them, and be the family that maybe they don't have in their own personal lives. Well, a while back they came to us and they were like, hey, wouldn't it be cool if Substance could provide foster kids with Christmas presents? A lot of these foster kids and these foster families don't have the resources that maybe we all have here at Substance. And so wouldn't it be cool if we all got them presents, and not just dumb little small presents, but like gifts that were like $50 to $100 cool. You know what I'm saying? Like something bigger than that. And so get this, here at Substance, this coming weekend, Substance is going to be providing these types of gifts to over 420 foster kids right here in Minnesota. Isn't that awesome? I love that. Think about that. Come on, they're coming right here to our church because of your generosity. I think that is so beautiful. And many of you probably don't even know this, but Substance actually houses a foster care storehouse that's here to resource foster families. And so, like, let's say a foster family gets a call to place a child sometime in the middle of the night, right? And that family suddenly needs diapers, they need clothing, they need car seats. Well, guess what? They come to Substance's storehouse so that we can provide some of those resources for these families. And it's all because of this couple, Mike and Missy. And I it's truly incredible to see how God can just take a single couple and use it to help our church impact our entire state. But what's interesting about that couple that a lot of people don't know is that only 8 years ago, their lives were a complete mess. In fact, Mike and Missy were not going to church. They had not been to a church in years, and back then they were not taking care of foster kids. Rather, they were spending all of their time and all of their money going clubbing, going to bars, and blowing all their money on alcohol. In fact, they even told me that their marriage, if they were truly honest, their marriage was on the fast track, headed towards divorce. In the midst of that dark season of their lives, though, they had a cousin who went to a crazy church with a crazy name called Substance. And their cousin was like, "Oh, Mike and Missy, you guys need to come to my church. I think you guys might love it there. And we have these Christmas services. You have to come to our Christmas services." And immediately Mike and Missy were like, yeah, no thanks. We're not really interested in church. In fact, they actually said no several times, okay? And part of it was because, kind of like those stats that I shared earlier, they just weren't comfortable checking their kids into a kids ministry with strangers. And it was stressful, the whole idea. And they're like, just no thanks. And finally the cousin was like, "Listen, I'm not going to take no for an answer. I will personally watch your kids if you will come to Substance's Christmas service." And they're like, "Wow, you're really excited about this. Okay." And so they finally agreed. They're like, "You know what? We'll come. Okay, we'll come, even if it's just to shut you up." You know what I'm saying? Like, I think a lot of people are kind of like that, right? So, and of course, they came to the Christmas services, and against all odds, they were totally caught off guard by it. The Holy Spirit so messed with them that after the service, they looked at each other, and they're like, "You know what? This is what we're missing in our lives. We are missing Jesus in our lives. We are missing, we need a church just like this." And so get this, even though they were living in Rochester, Minnesota at the time, they literally started driving 90 minutes to church right here at Substance every Sunday. Okay. 3 hours of driving every Sunday just to go to church, okay? That's how impacted they were. As we like to say, a church alive is worth the drive. And that's exactly what they were doing. Well, as if that wasn't enough, right? Mike was like, "You know what? This church has impacted me so much. I want to take it to another level." He decided to become an intern here at Substance. And you have to understand, many of our interns will work from dawn till dusk on a Sunday morning, right? Until the evening. And after immersing themselves in the church, they just were so impacted. And I always like to say that ministry is like a divine distraction that liberates us from the tyranny of our overly magnified needs. Some of us, the biggest thing that we struggle with is that we've just got nothing bigger than our problems. Sometimes God removes our problems, and sometimes he just gives us a purpose and a mission that's bigger than our problems. Or here's another thing I always tell people when they give their lives to ministry, just even if it's just in a small volunteer capacity, I really believe that you can't hold a torch to light another person's path without brightening your own. In other words, your own calling, your own path to life gets illuminated when you hold a torch to light up another person's path. Just serving other people, God ends up brightening your own path. He ends up illuminating your own destiny, your own plan to get fulfillment. And that's exactly what happened for Mike and Missy as they got involved in our church. All of a sudden, God started whispering to their hearts, "Listen, this is the type of church that could do great things for foster care. And this is the type of church, and God can use you." And that's exactly what happened. And I think about where it started. Well, it kind of started with something very, very simple. It started with a cousin who simply had the guts to invite them to our church. And on the surface, there was a million reasons to not invite Mike and Missy. I mean, come on. They live 90 minutes away. Is it really reasonable for them to drive 90 minutes to a church service, let alone ever come to a church by driving 90 minutes? I mean, that doesn't seem reasonable. I mean, besides, they're not even into church. They're into bars and nightclubs, right? And even more, they've already said no. I mean, think about it. There's a million reasons to not continue inviting them. And on the surface, Mike and Missy probably looked a lot like that picture of Death Valley that I showed you earlier. Nobody would have ever said that's the most likely couple that God would use to change the entire state when it comes to foster care. Nobody would have said, yeah, that's the type of soil that God's going to plant a beautiful harvest in. And yet, you know what? That's exactly what happened. And now there are senators and leaders who are coming to our church because of them. And every foster program in our state is clamoring to partner with them because of what God did in their lives, which ultimately is a part of the chain reaction because of what you guys did, the seeds that you sowed in even getting this church moving. And the reason why I'm sharing all of this is because I just believe that there are Mike and Missy's that are all over this city that are just waiting for the living water to fall on the soil of their lives. That they've got huge potential, potential that would change this city forever, and all they need is someone like you to invite them. I believe that the greatest future pastors of the church in America, maybe even the next senior pastor, is somebody that you're going to invite to this church. Could you imagine if the person you invited to church this year ended up becoming the pastor of this church? I mean, I just, God does that stuff. Because God did that with me. God did that with Mike and Missy. God did that with Philip and this Ethiopian that created a movement that exists to this day. And the question is not, does God want to do big catalytic things on the earth? The question is, are we willing to just obey that still small voice, just to be obedient to those small nudges of the Holy Spirit? That's what God uses to do huge miracles on the face of the earth. And how much more important is that in the midst of the greatest outreach in our church's year? Right here, starting at Christmas, right here in the new year, as we launch our Monterey campus, as we launch our Westside campus, God wants to move and God wants to use you. And so let God nudge you about inviting people. Let God nudge you even about participating in our Heart for the House offering today. And I'm telling you, some of you are just one little divine nudge away from the story of a lifetime, a story that we're going to talk about forever and ever and ever. Would you just bow your heads, close your eyes, and just let the Holy Spirit give you a divine nudge right now. God, I believe that you are bringing people to mind, that you are calling us to just give a text to, Lord, maybe even a simple invite, maybe a coffee date, just people you're calling us to just reach out to. Lord, I believe that right now that you're even convicting us in terms of how we're spending our time, our emotional resources, our finances, just helping us reorient to something that makes sense in light of eternity. And God, we just say, use us. Use us for a few wild goose chases, just like you used Philip. I pray that you do the same thing right here during this season of outreach, right here at Substance. And maybe you're here today and you're like, you actually relate more to the Ethiopian than you do to the story of Philip. You're like the guy or the gal who's just confused by this whole God thing. Listen, if you're just looking for a place to experience God right here, I just want to welcome you into our family. And if that's something you're even interested in, I'm just going to end with a simple little prayer. And I believe that if you just repeat this after me, God's going to use this to change your life forever. And so would you just do this? Everybody, would you all just join in praying a simple little prayer of rededication? And it goes just like this. Say this. Say, dear Jesus, forgive me, renew me, and lead me starting today and for the rest of my life. In Jesus' name we pray. If you agree with that prayer, say amen. 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 With all that said, we're going to have our campus pastors come on up and tell us where we're going to go next. Love you guys. We'll see you next week.